Good morning.
Good morning.
I'd like to welcome you all to this School of Science, Health, and Technology Frank Bragman Lecture for Black History Month. I'd first like to start by asking the chair of the Medgar Evers College Black History Month Committee, Professor Wallace Ford, to give us some opening remarks. Ladies and gentlemen, Professor Ford.
Thank you very much, and good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
But it is certainly my pleasure as co-chair of the Black History Month committee here at Medgar Evers College to bring some opening words of welcome and commentary. At first, I thought we have several members of the Black History Month committee who are here, who've been working assiduously over the last three, 4 months to get us to this point. And I'd like to ask them just stand and be recognized, please. I know I see Mr. McAfee here. So there is this expression when you do public speaking of any type. I was told a long time ago to remember the five B's, right, which is be brief, brother, be brief. So I will do that. But I do think it's important. Black History Month is always an important occasion and an important time for reflection. This year, 2018, I would submit to you is a little different. And in that regard, I just had a couple of quick remarks and then we will go on with the program. Because it should be clear to anyone and everyone who cares at all about the legacy of Black History Month that since January 20th, 2017, that legacy has been challenged. That legacy has been insulted, that legacy has been degraded. And as we celebrate and observe Black History Month, some perspective on history can be useful. Because Black History Month actually began as Negro History Week in 1926, and it was celebrated in February because there were the birthdays of Abraham Lincoln, February 12th, the birthday of Frederick Douglass, February 14th. The noted historian, G. Carter Woodson, and the Association for the Study of the Negro, wanted to celebrate and highlight the accomplishments of the African diaspora. It's also important to note the historical context. That was in 1926. By 1926, and this is from 1882 to 1964, at least 3,446 black men and women were lynched in these United States of America. Many of them by mobs that were considered to be fairly civilized under certain circumstances. In 1926, the Black National Anthem, words by James Weldon Johnson and music by John Rosamond Johnson, had been introduced and sung since 1900. What had it been happening? And during those 26 years, just between 1900 and 1926, Jim Crow segregation was cemented into the American way of life. So when we look at what we're doing here and continuing the celebration of what was Negro History Week, now Black History Month, and we are going to certainly have a recitation of the song, Lift Every Voice and Sing. We'd like to ask you just to think about the context. 1900 is when these words were written and then sung. Lift every voice and sing, till earth and heaven ring, ring with the harmonies of liberty, let our rejoicing rise, high as the listening skies, let it resound loud as the rolling sea. But remember that these words were written in 1900, ladies and gentlemen. Remember again that the horrors of human bondage were a recent memory. The people who were singing that song, the people who had written that song, everyone knew someone who had been in bondage if they had not been in bondage themselves. It was only 35 years earlier. Remember that the terror of the Ku Klux Klan lynching were very much in the present tense. Remember that as those words were written, the American shame and disgrace of Jim Crow were very much in the present tense. Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. The dark past is not a euphemism in this song, ladies and gentlemen. The dark past refers to the slave ships and the centuries of bondage and human trafficking and rape and torture and degradation, which were a real memory for the people who wrote that song and were singing that song in 1900 and then on into 1926. We should understand that the resilience reflected in these lyrics are accompanied by the theme of resistance. This is not a passive anthem, ladies and gentlemen. This is not a hymn in praise of eternal suffering. This song is a call to action. Facing the rising sun of our new day begun, let us march on until victory is won. That new day is a reference to emancipation, of course. and the new era that was occasioned. But we sit comfortably in the 21st century and find it difficult, not impossible, to understand what it could have been like to have no living relative who had ever lived in freedom. We find it difficult to imagine that profound effect, but here we are in 2018, and here we are celebrating Black History Month, and here we are looking at this notion of resistance and resilience, which is part of the tradition, I would submit to you, of Black Americans here in the United States. And so we celebrate all of that today. And I want to thank Dr. Blackman and all of the colleagues in the School of Science, Health, and Technology for putting this program together today, because it is such an important part of the overall theme that we have here at Medgar-Evers College. So I ask all of you to thank all of you for your participation, and want to encourage you to not just make Black History Month a 28-day affair. It is a 365-day-a-year affair, except every 4 years it's 366, right? So with that, please keep in mind that notion of resistance and resilience, and we will enjoy today. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Professor Wallace Ford. It's always good to be reminded of context, and so I think I'll just take 2 minutes to remind of context. So, we last year, the sort of organizing committee for this, we looked around and we thought that one of the things we wanted to do was to provide some real context for this event in the School of Science, to root it here. And, a number of names were proposed, but finally, I think we settled on Dr. Frank Radlin, who was a former member of our mathematics department who died some years ago, I think 2012. And so I just wanted to say, just a few words about Frank as a way of setting up our talk. So I'd written sort of on behalf of the organizing committee, we would like to welcome you to the second annual Frank Radlin Lecture to be held as part of our Black History Month offerings in the School of Science. Professor Wallace just talked about slavery, and so this is important. Frank was born in Montgomery, Alabama in 1941, and he was always proud to talk about the fact that he was a grandson of slaves. And he was the fifth child of his parents, a railroad mill clerk. And he constantly, those of you who would have had some interactions with him, he would talk very fondly and very, very emotionally about his time growing up in Alabama. But important for us was that, Frank's view was that we needed to create and nurture communities that supported our aspirations. And his life was really a testament to this philosophy. He did well in elementary school in I won't go through the entire history of it, but suffice to say that he went to elementary schools in Alabama, and one of the things he was always fond of saying is that when he moved, he was part of that group that moved to Chicago. When he went to Chicago, and he registered at college in Chicago, everyone thought that he couldn't do trigonometry, and he was reminded me that, in the Deep South at that moment, there were teachers who had come to the North and learned these things, and then they would have them in their houses, and they would teach them. So when he got to college, they thought that perhaps he would not be someone who would survive the trigonometry class. He'd actually done all of these things in the little houses in Montgomery, Alabama. And so, we really want this to be a little house in central Brooklyn, where when you leave this place, you will find great success. And I want to commend the faculty who are here, because we are already doing this thing of really creating a wonderful success. I know, last night I got a really beautiful email from one of our students. And I won't say who the student is, but just to give you a sense of the kind of thing that we're creating here in the sort of memory of Frank. It says, "Congratulations, you've been recommended for admissions to the PhD program in computer science in the Department of Computer Science and Engineering at Michigan State University with funding. Attached, please say, yes, with funding. Attached, you will find your official recommendation for admission letter and your funding letter. And if you choose to accept this offer, please sign both forms and return them to me as soon as possible via email. So here it comes. In the School of Science, we're really doing some remarkable things, and I just want to just once more acknowledge the faculty who are here with a round of applause for the work that they've been doing in this regard. Today we're graced with the presence of a really good friend of mine, someone who I've met and someone whose mathematics I have the utmost respect for. Many times I've tried to learn some things about string theory, and I haven't succeeded. And I've listened to Boyo talk about string theory, and I think I have some sense of what this means. I've heard him really talk about super complicated things and make them sound really, really simple. And I was always reminded some of you who think about this, there's a wonderful piece by Feynman which tells us about if you really understand something, you should be able to say it to a baby. So if you say it and it's really complicated, then you really don't understand it. And so yes, that's true. My goal is always to sort of have people come here who I think really understand things in the deepest possible way. And I think today we have someone who really understands things in the deepest possible way. And I want to ask one of our students, Spetty Ortiz, to introduce today's speaker for us. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back.
My pleasure to introduce Dr. Jonathan Mboyo Esole, which is a Congolese mathematician working on the geometry of string theory. He has solved several important problems in mathematical physics. His work is supported by the U.S. National Science Foundation, and Mboyo was trained at UOB in Belgium, Cambridge University in the United Kingdom, Leiden University in Netherlands, Stanford and Harvard at the United States. He has won several awards and he has held several prestigious positions, such as the best thesis in the science at UOB, Wehner Ansbach Grant to Cambridge University, Ford Fellowship, and Marie Curie Fellowship. After serving for 3 years as Benjamin Pierce Assistant Professor at Harvard University, where he worked with Fields medalist Xin Tong Yao, Dr. Esole joined the math department of Northeastern University in September 2016. Then, in September 2017, he was named as one of the next Einstein Forum Fellows. This award that celebrates the best young scientists and technologies from Africa. He's passionate about access to STEM education to all the corners of the African diaspora, Europe, the Americas, and the Caribbean. He's one of the founders of STEM DRC and is involved in several partnerships to advocate for the education of young women in Africa. So please help me welcome Dr. Mboyo Esole.
Hi, everybody.
Hello.
What's up? I'm really proud and I'm really happy to be here with you. So I'm coming from Boston. And in my career, I've always been traveling around the world, and I see that the people who spoke before me are so well-dressed. I want to acknowledge that. I'm from the Congo. You have a reputation to dress better than everybody else, but I need to explain this. My t-shirt is a CONS t-shirt. This is the conference for African American who do research in mathematics, and that's where I meet Terrence, another great mathematician. So this is a conference that inspired me. You have the opportunity to meet students who have paths that are very different from my path. And I get to appreciate everybody's way to discover mathematics and to celebrate mathematics. So when I give a talk, and so you know, you heard I was in Cambridge, in Harvard or whatever, but this is Michigan University. That's where the last conference was. And so I just want to celebrate our people and introduce some new big names that we have, like CONS should be like a name that people wear proudly. So the subject of my talk is STEM and the African diaspora. So I have way too many slides. And my idea is to try to go as far as I can. And I think of it more as a discussion than anything else. I have some string theory in it. But my purpose today is really to talk. I'm sorry for all the professors. My audience are really the students. So I want to hang out with them. They are the cool people in the room. And I want to look cool to my son as well. So let's see if I... Okay. So for today's talk, I actually want to do like my son does in kindergarten. So every day when they start school, the professor asks them to write a sentence or two. They have to tell the stories. And last time when I was at evaluation, they told me there is really a problem with your son. He doesn't write sentences, he keeps on asking questions. So then I read my son's like question, and he asked questions like, why are they boys and girls? Why do we have breakfast? And questions like that. And then I thought, this might not be very good for kindergarten, but that might be very good down the road as a researcher. So now my point of view is that if I'm going to go talk to young people, I don't want to come and tell them what life is. I have no idea myself, according to my wife. However, I can raise some questions and we can try to find answer together. So the first question is who I am. So I'm looking at me like in that Michael Jackson song, you know, the man in the mirror. And I can't do the dance move, but I can do string theory. So how do I introduce myself? So the easy way is to first say my first name, I'm Boyo, and I'm a mathematician. Usually when I do that, it doesn't end up very well, because people are like, I can't really pronounce it, destruction. So I said, okay, my Christian name is Jonathan. My mom loved that name. Jonathan is a Hebrew name. Jonathan means God has given. I am a gift of God. So you know, so then they get confused and they ask me, which one shall I use? Should I call you Mboyo? Should I call you Jonathan? We just had this exchange 2 minutes ago with my neighbor. And I think I'm a prophet because I predicted this could happen. And I want to say, you know, you pick whatever you want. It's okay. You know, it's just the same person. And the reason it works like this is because I'm from a culture where names have a meaning, and we end up having a lot of names. And being able to negotiate the name and understand which one to use in the best moment is an art in itself. You know, it comes with culture. So then after I talk about my name, I have to go back and say, yes, I'm a mathematician. But then you're also black. So then, this usually is a moment where, depending on who you talk to, they're really excited that you're black, or they start questioning if you're really a mathematician. And that's also part of the struggle we go through. So just to put things into perspective, this is my path in academia and somehow in life. So I was born in Kinshasa, the Democratic Republic of the Congo, please. That used to be called Zaire. Then I moved to Brussels as a child. Then I moved back to Kinshasa as a teenager. And I went back to Brussels for college when I was studying mathematics, and I had a really good time in college. I won't get into the details, but I also got my first paper as an undergraduate student. And based on that, I managed to get a scholarship to Cambridge. And I just want to mention that there were nobody that would sit with me to go through all the program to see which scholarship I could apply to. So working, like living as a student in Belgium is much cheaper than here. Tuition might be like $1,000 or $2,000 maximum, and people complain that it's too expensive. So I had to work through my school, and sometimes it was before the internet was really cool, so I have to go to different buildings to read in small letters every opportunity for applying for any grant. So I will always apply to grants. I have a schedule that I apply to grant every month, basically regardless. If I don't fill the criteria, I write a very long letter explaining why I should still qualify. So I got a few like scholarships here and there, but then for Cambridge, I got the biggest scholarship you can actually get for Cambridge University. And it's even bigger than the one you get from the Gates Foundation. So when I was in Cambridge, it was a good time and a hard time because I lost my dad. And after that, I question a bit what are my priorities in life, because I'm one of these guys who is like extremely competitive, and I like to see, you know, when my dad, I tell him I was the best student at university, you know, the smile, the pride in his face. I was living for that moment. So when my dad passed away, it was really tough to redefine what was really my priority. And I even questioned if I was going to stay in academia or not. So I needed a total change of scenery. And I got it by doing my PhD in the Netherlands, a country where I know exactly nobody. So it was like completely fresh. So after that, I had the opportunity to visit Cape Town with the AIMS Institute, the African Institute of Mathematical Studies. So I'm friends with the founder, and I helped them recruit the first class. So I was an assistant for a class. And for me, it was a defining moment because it was my first time in life that I actually saw other African people who do math. Usually it was me and this other person who doesn't talk to me for some reason. Sometimes, you know, when you're a minority, people turn into like electrons. They can't cohabit in the same state with some distance. So then I went back to Leiden. I had an opportunity to be a visiting student to Stanford. And just for the student, I want to explain how I ended up in Stanford. So I solved an old problem in supergravity that involved quaternionic geometry and cosmic strings. And there is this very famous Stanford professor that was giving lectures across Europe, Renata Kalosh. So I go to a lecture. And after the lecture, before the famous people go and take her for dinner, I basically went straight to her and I said, "Hi, I'm Boyle." And then she was like, "Yes." And I said, "I wrote the paper on cosmic strings. And I think it would be great for Stanford to have me." And then she started laughing. And she said, "OK, we have to talk." And I mentioned to her my supervisor is also a female. I am one of the few with a female supervisor. And she has two very young children, and she won an award that gave her millions of dollars of funding for traveling and so on, and I take responsibility of using the funds. So if you invite me to Stanford, I basically pay for everything. So then it was a deal. I went to Stanford, I met a lot of people, and this is actually the people that I met when to go to Harvard, I met them first in Stanford. So then after that, for my first postdoc, I went to Leuven University for sentimental reasons. So my wife, my girlfriend at the time, was in Belgium. And we always live in different countries. In science, they call it a two-body problem. So since I had the opportunity to go almost where I wanted for postdoc, I decided to go where my love was. And everybody called me an idiot. After a few months, I got an offer to join the department at Harvard. So then I decided that love is important. but let's just do this one at least. So I went to Harvard, first in the physics department. I was a postdoc. Everybody was kind of working on exactly the same thing. And there was, you know, in physics, sometimes you want to solve things, but it's difficult to solve anything. So people have an idea about what is true. But these ideas sometimes are purely mathematical, so they really conjecture. They don't necessarily check them all the time. And one of these conjectures, I was pretty sure was not what people expected it to be. And so I went to Professor Xingtong Yao, who is one of the top mathematicians in the world, field medalist, a very scary guy too. And I told him that I think this is not right, and I think I have a way to prove it. So he told me, you know, when I solve his famous conjecture, it's called the Calabi conjecture, I first actually proved that it was wrong, and then I realized it was right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I don't know about your proof, but I'm interested in that you're actually challenging that. So what about you try, and you know, I hire you, and just try to do it, and if it fails, it's okay. So we worked through it, we actually proved that our idea were right, and it kind of turned this part of string theory into a part that was defined by a lot of conjecture, into a part when you could actually do proof, compute things, and this helped me have a career. So after Harvard, I moved to Northeastern University, which is very convenient because it's like across the corner or something. So I didn't have to change my apartment, and my wife kept her job because it was not a given that we have to move for me, actually. So it was super convenient for us to stay in Boston. My student is still at Harvard completing PhD. I want to have a shootout for Monica Peng, who is the student with who I work really closely right now. She couldn't make it today. So back to the origin, as I said, I was born in the Congo, in Africa, and at the time it was still called Zaire. You know, in Africa we have a lot of revolution, every time we change the name of the country, and so on. So I need to explain where I'm from. When people tell me you're a black mathematician, in my head I'm like, that's not me, I'm not a black mathematician. My dad is from the Mongo tribe, that's where I'm from. And my mom is from the Congo Kingdom. Actually, I should have write this Congo with a K, like Congo. And I was sitting to my brother Hidley from the Haiti. So when I am in Boston, every person from Haiti come to me and speak to me in Creole. And I'm like, moi pas parler Creole. But they see my face and they think I am from the country. And the reason is that a lot of my brother from the Congo Kingdom was shipped a slave to Haiti. So for me, when I'm recognized in the street of Boston as a member of the Haitian community, I don't mind because this is my people. And so this is who I am. I'm not like a black mathematician. If I really have to define myself, I'm going to talk about my roots. And all of us, we have roots. And as a community, like what people call the black community, we really have to remember that other people are not going to define us. We have to define ourselves. So then my family moved to Europe. And so for me, it was an interesting move. When I was 3 years old, I had a near-death experience. So they told my parents, your child passed away. I had a heart condition, but somehow I came back. So there were just like nurses running like, ghost, just like me, coming back. But then it left me with all kinds of problems. I couldn't really use my hand correctly. I couldn't use like my tongue, I couldn't pronounce a lot of words. And so moving to Europe also, we went for my father was doing a PhD in anthropology and philosophy. And for me, I had a lot of medical help. I actually learned to pronounce my first name, Boyo, with a nurse that was actually Flemish. So she couldn't understand that you actually pronounce it Boyo. She would tell me it's M. Boyo. So I go home and my father will ask me, what is your name? And I'm like, M. Boyo. And then he's like, no, it's Moyo. Then I was like, no, I'm Moyo. What I heard. And he tells me, I'm an anthropologist. I do a PhD in anthropology, and I am your dad. I choose that name. So maybe you should follow my recommendation. But then I was like, but the lady, you know, the white lady. And so this is something I always tell my people, that, you know, you have to know who you are, and people who know who you are usually your own people. So growing up, I grew up as a special need child, so I would go to school with my brother and sister, and then I go to a special program where I basically like have to catch up with a lot of things. So obviously at school then I was not really that good to start with, but I was also very proud, so it was not really a big deal for me. I was like, okay, I can do these things, but I'm really good at doing some other things that I didn't know exactly what they were at the time. I just fought, and my brother was my hero. Whatever my brother do in the playground, in my head I would believe that it's me doing it. So I was like living for my brother. Now he's a doctor in Brazil. And I finally could pronounce my name. So then we moved back to Africa, and that was not an easy move, because most people will assume we will stay in Europe, but my dad is one of these people who have really strong belief into home is home and you have to do your path there. So he used to be an orphan himself. He ended up being like a professor at university, and he said no to a job in Europe to go back teach in Africa. But for me, all my brother and sister were crying, they were losing their friends and so on. But for me, it was a pretty good deal. Because, you know, there is this cartoon that we watch on TV. It's called Lucky Luke. It's a cowboy with a dog and a horse. And every time they will meet bad people in the cartoon, at the end of the cartoon, they will become good people, and they will say, I'm moving to San Francisco to start a new life. a city where nobody knows them. So for me, moving to the Congo was like, I have all these things, people know me, the guy who has hands that just go like this for no reason and so on, who can pronounce his name. Now I go to a new country, I can actually start a new life. So I was very excited. And also I thought, you know, I'm going to be like everybody else. Like growing up in Europe at the time, the only black people that you would be very proud to name were like Michael Jackson, Prince, Muhammad Ali. And people like that were like our proud, but I couldn't name any like scientists from Africa except for my dad. And I couldn't even explain to my friend what my dad was doing. I would tell them, the other would say, my dad is a plumber. And people would be, And then I'd be like, my dad is writing a thesis. So people were like, he's a writer. And I'm like, no, he's a researcher. Why is he not a finder? So with kids, this were, the PhD program was not really like a thing they look up to. So moving to Africa was a bit like a moment for me. And I actually also started to define myself as a mathematician at the time. Because I couldn't write properly. My French writing skills are very low. I was doing a lot of typo. I still do like, I'm sure I have plenty of typo in here. But I was getting away with it because people would say, well, you know, he was a special need child. Nobody really expected him to do anything great. So spelling, we give it a pass. But then as the math was getting more fancy, I really could understand what it was about. And I had this book that my dad gave me about Albert Einstein, who used to be like a kid with, at least in the book, they claim he had some problem as well. So for me, I took a lot of pride in this guy because I'm like, he's one of us, those who are not really that good at school, you know? And he managed to be one of the best of them. So I really owned the name. I was like, yes, I can also be like a scientist. And I really like mathematics a lot. So my first introduction to mathematics was my father had a lot of books. He was in the humanities. So his books were all about philosophy and so on. So my first math introduction was through philosopher. like René Descartes, who tried to explain why you need God to sustain the existence of everything else. I will read the Lalande Dictionary of Philosophy when they will have an article about positivism, which was a theory of social science that we then use in quantum mechanics to explain why the way we describe quantum mechanics makes no sense, but is still useful because we can get just results to questions. So the point of view was very philosophical. And I grew up in a very Catholic family. And mathematics also had that thing that it was extremely pure. And it has this weight of being able to have eternal truth. Because for me, I was really young, like when I was young, meaning 10 years old, I was passionate by René Descartes. I was going to a Jesuit school. He went to a Jesuit school. He's one of our best alumni, together with Fidel Castro, from the Jesuit school. So I was aware of his work. And the idea that what you do in math is true forever was very powerful to my mind, because I'm like, we humans are dust coming from the stars. You know, our atoms are created in the heart of stars that are dying. And for us to be able to be here as an accident and be able to write things that are true forever is a pretty good deal. And since we're all gonna be like dying sometime, and someone like me, I was aware that I would have probably a short life because I didn't start very good. The idea of embracing eternity was very powerful. I was like, this is almost when God said, I created you in my image. For me, that was what it meant. You can create eternal truth. So then there is also this idea that mathematics is history of universality. So you will see people have studied triangle in Egypt. You will see a theorem that you can see in Greece or in Babylon. The same theorem can be seen sometime in civilization that was not in touch. I take pride that the oldest mathematical object on Earth is from the Congo. It's called the Shongo bone. And you look at the structure of some African villages, and you see how it's structured by symmetry, where there is a morphism between your social statue and the geometry. I just thought mathematics, on top of being like a hard science, is a science that tells the story of the humankind. We are travelers, we explore the world, we go from point A to point B, we cross oceans, we do not build walls, but we go through mountains. And so I just thought this was an important part of being a mathematician. And then you had these problems. So, you know, when you are like a child who couldn't do anything, and then the professor writes something on the board, and then you look at the class, and nobody can stand, and then you stand up, you go to the board, you write everything, you go back, you sit down, and then you stand up again to put the full stop. At the end of your statement, I just thought this was the coolest thing ever, because you can kind of solve problems. Some of them are easy, some of them are hard. You never know if you're gonna be able to do it. So every time you have kind of to challenge yourself. And I have a hard time challenging myself in sport because I have limitation. So for me, I was like, all these guys who defeat me in soccer, basketball, and so on, I couldn't defeat them in that. And I took a lot of pride in that. To the point that my mom once sat me in the kitchen and told me, you need to learn to be humble. And then I told her, I didn't get where I am by being humble. And then she said, yes, this is kind of true, but now it's enough. Now you can be humble. So, okay, so this, because I'm a scientist, I also want to share like a piece of math with you today. And I just want to start with a story like how a certain topic was born, how it was developed, born from stupid ideas, developed by genius, and how I intersected with that topic and came up with a theorem. That's kind of explained usually the process. So this is a city like in the days that has in Europe, that has a lot of bridges, and people were asking simple questions of the type, is it possible to go through all the bridges without passing twice by the same bridges? And that question is usually, you would assume this is like a quiz you ask kids. It's actually relatively hard to find a solution, but once you find a solution, you go like, oh, that was actually easy. And the question was asked, and the question was answered by one of the greatest, Euler, who is every mathematician think of Euler as the like hero. And he explained why there were no solution. And by doing this, he introduced the notion of Euler characteristic. So usually when I go and I like talking to kids, I kind of feel like I'm talking to my parents, according to my wife. So this is one of the things I do with kids that can count, I compute Euler characteristic with them. And there are ways where you can explain the cut and paste technique of topology, that you can actually teach kids to compute Euler characteristic of relatively complicated objects. Because the Euler characteristic is a counting device. It preserves an invariant, which is something that does not change when you kind of deform the object. And in simple situation, it's defined by this formula. So now the Euler characteristic that Euler introduced were really defined for surfaces. And there is a more fancy mathematical way to describe it using what is called alternative sum of Betti numbers. And normally when you introduce Betti numbers, there are a lot of conditions to explain when they exist and what it means for them, what condition we ask the space, in here I call it a manifold, to actually have Betti numbers. Then in string theory, Euler characteristics are used to compute all kinds of things related to physics, the number of generation in a Calabi-Yau, the number of different brains. So here I know that you guys don't understand this world, I'm just bragging, you know. And in Mass theory, it's also very useful. In Mass theory, actually, the Euler characteristic is used in concrete application when you study like real problems of applied mathematics. So there were times, so one of my expertise in string theory is the study of elliptic vibration. Elliptic vibration are basically the type of space you get if you take a donut and you make it move around Central Park. You have kind of a donut that moves over a surface, and it's called a vibration, and the fiber is the donut. But then, interesting thing happens when the fiber becomes singular. So a donut becomes singular if you bite the donut, for example, or if you take one of the circles of the donut and you shrink it to a point, it becomes singular. And it happens that in math donuts, we call them elliptic curves. Elliptic curves are some of the very oldest objects studied in mathematics, all the way from the Egyptians. They were studying cubic curves that are elliptic curves. And I was passionate by the fact that this ancient structure is actually using the most modern theory of physics and string theory. And people like Ed Witten and Kuhn Waffer computed the Euler characteristic of spaces of a very specific dimension. And I didn't realize why it's important to fix the dimensionality. Since that object is so important, it should be possible to kind of embrace it in one breath. So Paolo Aluffi is an expert in singularity theory. So I sent him an email once telling him I want to compute Euler characteristic of singular spaces, and Google said that you're the expert. I sent to him and maybe 20 other people. He was the only one to answer. And he told me, so right now I am the head of my department. I have a lot of administrative staff, so I probably have no time to discuss this further, but what do you really mean by question number two? So then I answered question number two. We started talking more, and we started having a collaboration. And out of this collaboration, we produced this formula, which is a rational function. And if you expand this rational function, you can actually obtain the Euler characteristic of a variety of any dimension. It's like a generating function for that. So this now is a classic result that people will learn in a class on elliptic vibration. But then most singular fibers actually have really bad similarities, and it would be important to be able to produce the same formula in cases that, for example, represent the geometry that you see for the standard model. So this collaboration here is one of my very favorite collaboration. So by the way, when I write me, I really mean me. I mean me. But me also my initial is Amboyo Esole. Okay. So don't get confused. So Monica Kang, she's a PhD student at Harvard in the physics department. Patrick Jefferson is a student, so her supervisor is Dan Jeffrey, who's famous string theorist. Patrick Jefferson is a student of Kumon Vafa, and he's an African-American student. So here you have a paper, some guy from like the Congo, like the forest in the Congo, some lady from South Korea. She's one of the extremely few string theorists, female string theorists from South Korea, and an African-American guy. And we introduced this theorem that allowed people to compute the other characteristic of everything you want. So now we go to the question, like, what does it mean to be black? So I already told you that for me, it doesn't really mean anything, because in my context, I can put more things to it. For like, I like what was said before when they mentioned that someone was from Alabama, and for him to be black meant to be black in Alabama. And you cannot disassociate this with the heritage of slavery. So to be black means a lot of things. So I'm bringing question, is this just a color? Is it culture? Is it history? Is it like a birthright? Can you say to someone, I'm black, and then you get stuff? Is it a responsibility? Does it mean that if you're black all of a sudden, except for everything that everybody else have to do, you have another list all of a sudden that you're also supposed to do? So for those of you who are faculty, what I mean is, if you are in a department in the US, if you're black, does it mean that any initiative of like trying to outreach mean that you have to be on the email? So for example, you have to be on every committee that talk about being black. Your colleagues, they don't have to do that. So these are the kind of question that comes naturally. But one thing that we have in common is that black people, I like to think of us more as the African diaspora, we are very resilient. You know, I'm a mathematician, so I can do a proof. The proof is that you guys are here. There are a lot of reasons why you shouldn't be here. A lot of reasons. Maybe your ancestors would not have survived what they went through. Maybe they would have been too proud and they would have jumped from all of them from ships. Maybe you would have decided that this world is totally not for you. You want to go to the other world. Maybe you would have given up and decided to be just sitting in the corner of a street, but you're here. So what defines us first is that we are connected by a history where we always have to struggle. We always have to kind of be generous about being survivors. So we have a hard time giving people a hard time about our hard time. Other people do a better job of it. So for us, it's more like we have to keep on going. But we have to be aware that, you know, certain things that we win, we should not take them for granted because they can easily be taken away from us. Like a few years ago, we had an amazing president and we thought that we just created the perfect world. And all of a sudden, we were reminded that other people have a different opinion on what the world should look like. And so, you know, like President Obama said, change comes in waves. You do a few steps ahead, then you stop, you go back, and then we always have to go back. And if we don't go back, our children go back. So when I see another black person, I don't care if they think they're not black, if they tell me, no, I'm a Latino, that's okay. It's the same story. When I see someone from the Caribbean, the black community in Europe, where people have a tendency to try to embrace the country they are in, I just remember that when the time is gonna be hard, they would be identified as not completely European. You know, I'm from the Congo. I know what happens in my country and around my country with genocide. I know what happened when people came to our land and decided to label us Tutsi and Hutu, things that was not from us. So we are carrying a lot of baggage, and we should always be very careful that everything we have, we should not give away. So we cannot like just be scientists, for example. We have to be scientists with a memory. We always have to remember what we're supposed to do and where we're coming from. So then the question is, the next question is, what does it mean to be successful? So for me, this is a very interesting question, because the way I look at myself is like somebody who was not very successful. And then I got some what people call success, and they really assume I am, but that's not how I see myself. So I also like how people are afraid of big words. I can have a conversation in Cambridge with someone, and then I can mention to them, hey, I was a Harvard faculty, and then they shut down. You know, so I'm always impressed by how we are afraid to try to see through symbols of success. So one of the reasons I'm dressed like this today is to tell people that I'm really just a regular dude who have done a few things and who is not even half of where he actually want to be. For me, my definition of success is not what I have done so far. This is like nothing. I hope I can do much better. And yeah, so this is like a question that is on my mind all the time. At a certain point, success was really like the prod in my father's eyes. And then when my father was not there, I had to redefine success. So what is success for me? So this is like a question in progress. And at a certain point, I could finally say Moyo. It was my name. Growing up, I couldn't ride a bicycle, and then I do my PhD in the land of bicycles. So my supervisor gave me a bicycle, because somehow I forgot to bring one, and she said, okay, you just live 20 minutes away from the department on bicycles, so here's a bicycle, you go home, you bring it back every day, and it's yours, you can keep it. It's cheap enough that if they steal it, it's not a big deal. So then I was like, I just lost my dad and I was trying to redefine my world. And here I am with a bicycle. And I don't know how to ride it. So I decided that my first challenge in this country is to take my bicycle to campus on the bicycle. And I tried many times. And I still have the scarf of that. And eventually I realized that equilibrium was actually a gift that was also given to me. So during my PhD, people always ask me, what is the biggest result of your PhD? Was it to prove the existence of cosmic string in N equal to supergravity? Or this other result you got about BRST symmetry? And in my head, I was like, the bicycle. Yes, the bicycle.
Wormhole.
And surviving my dad's death was also one of my success, because if you're a sick child and you know that you don't have a long life expectation, you don't plan for the future. You basically don't have a vision of you as a old person or a dad or a husband. So all these things I had to build them, because I realized that in my department at Cambridge was Stephen Hawking, but he is like on a wheelchair. He has survived many of his colleagues that were healthy. And I just survived my dad. I thought this would never happen to me. I was actually telling myself that one of the advantages of my situation is that I'm never gonna see my family member pass away. And so I had to kind of try to accept that I'm not master of the time, and my life might be end up being longer than what I expected to be. So here, I want to, so this picture are basically all the women that helped me be successful. My supervisor, Ana Chucao, she's in the corner there with the white hair. It's just, you know, she's Spanish, she's a blonde. People get always surprised. Next to her is Renata Kalosh, the professor who invited me to Stanford. The one standing on the chair, she was a professor, Mathilde Marconi. She was professor in the Max Institute in Germany. And she was one of the person who invited me to my first high profile conference where I was a speaker. And everybody thought I was going on stage to fix the mic or something. Next to her is the person who taught me how to be compassionate when I teach students. Sometimes when you're very tough with yourself, you think that everybody is just like a ninja warrior. And for me, learning to teach was learning to actually realize that that's not true, and you need to be compassionate. And she taught me that, and I'm very thankful. Next, you have all my collaborators. So I have a lot of female collaborators. They keep on bossing me around, all these things. In the middle of the picture is my current student, Monica. All of them are very close friends. So at the corner here, you have a young lady that is all over the internet. She built an airplane when she was a 13 years old girl in Chicago. She built the airplane and then she flew the airplane she built. Every time she tells me that, I'm just like, wow. So people mention I'm a next Einstein fellow. For me, you know, if you're a physicist and people call you next Einstein, it's a huge embarrassment to your colleagues who keep on making fun of you. And the reason why I went into like having the title that is very like annoying to carry is because it gave me the opportunity to reach out to my country and bring some change. And when I got the award, I decided to really work with people in my country more than the organization itself. And I was reaching out to a lot of people. And I sent so many emails. I get guys telling me so many great things and then not doing anything. But then I have these two ladies that told me very little things, but very concrete things that came up with some realization. So one of them, Sandrine Mubenga, she's a professor of applied science in Ohio, and Raisa Malou, she's our NEF ambassador, and she created the Week of Science in the Congo, and she's really out there trying to bring STEM education in Africa. So this is like my team. And so now I want to tell you a story about Hollywood. So recently, I've been working with an organization called Malaika. It's an organization that tries to help young girls in the Congo have an education. So they put themselves not in the capital city, but they put themselves in a small community where there were nothing. They build infrastructure. They came up with solutions for water by digging the building, and they're giving this girl 2 meals a day and an education. So I was approached with one of the founders of Malaika, the CEO, is a very famous model. Now she's a friend of mine. I always like to mention that. And she's like an amazing person. So she was born in the Congo. She lost her dad when she was 5. Her name is Noela Corsaris. And when she came back at age 20, she saw the situation of young girls and she decided to do something about it. So she built this structure, and she reached out to me, telling me, we need you. And I got a lot of, we need you email. But in her case, she will not let me go. She will insist, she will want to talk more, and then I realized she's a go and get it type of person. And that's the people I like to work with. So I started having Skype meetings with the girls in the school. They started with kindergarten, and each year they added a class. And now they have grade 7. Girls are starting to do some serious math. So I started interviewing the professor, the student, and so on. I gave them a test. I identified problem they have. And I identified a solution to address them. And the solution to address them came from technique I learned when I was at Harvard. The first class I taught, I felt I was not ready to teach American students. So I asked if I could work with a group of struggling students. So they told me, okay, we have some struggling student here. If you want to try it, good luck, try. And all the students I work with are very successful people Now they do amazing things, and they're also very modest with their shipment. But what I learned was different techniques to make people work in group, build confidence, celebrate everybody's success, and every time there is a mistake, use that mistake as a stone for the next success. So people, even when they make mistakes, they're like, I contributed. So now this is these girls, you see them working in group. I bring question, they bring answer, they bring additional question. And my son, I do the Skype in the morning, I'm like completely tired, it's the time difference. And we do the Skype interview, and my son will wake up and he will be like, let's plan, like, no, I have to do the Skype. So he was kind of annoyed that somebody was stealing us our Saturday morning between, you know, me and my son. So then there is this movie that came out, it's called The Black Panther. So my son, being a fan of like superheroes, he was like, Dad, we absolutely have to watch The Black Panther. So we went to the movie and, you know, we brought people, so we were wearing like our African clothes. Me and my son, we were wearing our African clothes, watched the movie. And when we came back from the movie, so these are the picture of Malaika, I told him that what I do with the girl is building Wakanda. This is what we do. And then he was very proud and he asked me, how can I help? I told him, just share the time with your daddy, with the girls, that would be enough. And I want to make this point, it's so important. You know, you can have like one string theorist that was a traveler, or I don't know where he would end up. This is like nothing. The real point here is that we have a community that is spread across countries and continents, and we are really a people, and we are an oppressed people, and we are survivors. We even have the psychological hurts of 500 of abuse, years of abuse, and we are not going to be successful by trying to be successful alone. We have a responsibility to our blood to do this type of things. Reach out to the weakest people in our community. In Africa, the weakest people are sometimes the women. They represent 50% of our population. Actually, it's a bit more because guys do stupid things and die early. So for me, it's not possible to think of like reaching out in terms of science without putting women before. Because if you understand the African culture, you know that every single institution in Africa is based on women. Every single institution. In the Congo Kingdom, it was a matrilinear line. They know you through your mother blood. My dad, they know them from the father line, so I have a double family in my case. But it's extremely important to be able to see each of these little girls who are in villages and think of them that this might be the mother of a Barack Obama, a Nelson Mandela or something. So this is the structure of our culture. You look here in America, who are in colleges, you realize that our women are our everything. So I just want to emphasize that this is a goal that we should really focus on. We have to develop our community across land. So I want to give lectures in Colombia. I want to go to the Caribbean. I want to go to every single corner. And when I talk about reaching out to my people, it's not an exclusive thing. It just happened that we had a very tough time. If you make a university friendly to the people who had a really tough time, even everybody else will feel welcome in that place. So we talk about the African struggle, and we don't close it to other people. For the history of us surviving things, we had allies of all community too. So this is the month of February. I'm from the Congo. So I just want to finish with a picture of Professor Malu. This is the dad of one of the ladies I showed you before. He is one of the first to get a degree in science. He passed away in 2011. I realized he doesn't have a Wikipedia page. So for me and my friends to celebrate February, we are creating one for him. And I'm going to finish with the following story. So in Kinshasa, there were looting in the city, and the military would go to every house and steal everything. And once I was in the market, and I saw somebody buying, I don't know if it was candy or something like that, robbing the paper. Then I look at the paper, and I see Schrodinger equation on the paper. So I asked him, where did you get this? And he said, oh, the candy, I got it from this lady. So I go to the lady and I ask her, where is the paper you use? And she said, oh, this is from this book. And I look at the book, and the book was related to the nuclear center that was one of the institutions where Professor Malou was actually responsible. It's probably one of his books. And then I thought, I really want to have this book. So I told the lady, I'm going to give you a few dollars for your trash. And then she was like, fine. So she gave me the book. It was missing a few pages. And it was my first introduction to Cantor mechanics. So when I met his daughter, I had to tell her, I have something to confess. I had one of your dad's book from the looting in Kinshasa. Mm-hmm. And then she said, my dad would have been very proud to have missed that book. I'm going to stop here.
I sort of knew that it would be great. Thank you so much. You know, I'm not going to say anything. I wait for a moment before I say anything. I wanted to acknowledge the presence of our provost, Provost Agostino Ferreque, who has, you know, really been a supporter of science, and I want to know whether you mind saying a few words on the
is my brother from another mother in Congo. You know, we've had a very, very inspirational story here, you know, a journey that will be so great for our students to hear. Despite the setbacks, you know, he was able to achieve, he was able to prevail. You know, when I called the dean this morning, and I told him that I'm not feeling well, feeling sick, so I won't be able to come. I come very late, and I wouldn't speak. You know, I was also trying to dodge away from speaking before mathematicians. Because going to college, I said, oh my God, you know, this mathematics follows you everywhere. Even when I was reading a master's degree in African literature in Nigeria, I was asked to take a class in statistics. I said, my God, when will they still leave me alone? You know, but that underlines the importance of math, you know, that we need math in every field. And your story is so inspirational, you know. I wish we'll have time. We'll invite you again to a bigger crowd, you know, so our students will listen to you to see how, you know, through perseverance, you know, we are very, very inspirational. We have things that move us along. And the president will have been here, but he's in a meeting, and he said to bring this, you know, goodwill. I'm really sick, actually, I didn't want to say anything, but having listened to him, you know, I said I have to, you know, say something and to welcome you to America and to, you know, listen to your story and the conclusion and the fact that, you know, you went through all this and you still are able to achieve, to accomplish is something great. And looking how ordinary you look. Okay, so thank you very much. Thank you, Dean, for this opportunity.
So we're right up against the 1 o'clock hour, and so I think there's some stuff available for us outside. And so I thought perhaps maybe we could just take one question, one or two questions, if someone has a nice, quick, short question. Yes, go ahead, sorry.
Well, first of all, let me say thank you very much, you know, for the presentation. And I'm so excited that you did not listen to the brother from Montgomery, Alabama. Don't be beef, brother. Be brief, brother. Do not tell your story. Tell your story and continue to tell your story. And there is much more in you than you have become, for sure. I'm certain of that. You have achieved some absolutely amazing things, but I'm certain that you have not achieved even 50% of what stands before you. It's an absolutely wonderful story. I enjoyed it very much. Thank you.
Yes, go ahead, Steve.
Yes, Ken, thank you for your inspirational story. I see that through your journey that you were kind of like really redefining things for yourself, bringing things into perspective. And I wonder, like, how did you kind of pace yourself in like making decisions and trying to rebuild Wakanda? Like all these different ideas that are coming, how do you pace yourself through these transition points?
Yeah, that's a very interesting question. So first, I just want to say that this is also what we do in mathematics. So I said in math, we try to build eternal truth. So individual truths are eternal, but how they relate to each other is very dynamical. So I like to think of math as a structure, like a cathedral, in which every few years you can change the position of stone, because you realize that the cathedral is stronger if you put that other stone in the basement rather than on top. But then when it comes to myself, I usually go into circles. I try to question, I treat my own opinion as the enemy opinion and try to take it down. I try to talk to a lot of people, and sometimes I have to ignore what they think, but also I have to believe that I'm on earth to achieve something. So when things become a bit too tough, I need to have something more than myself to continue doing. So I remember when I was in college, I was a sick person. My brother Campos was bombed in the Congo, so he did 3 years of medical school. So I took two free jobs to kind of pay for him to join me in Europe. And after that, I had a cost of, during the year I couldn't use my hand because of the consequences of that. But today he's a doctor saving lives. So I really try to believe in people. And usually the people are more important than the cause itself. So if you see somebody and you believe that there is something genuine in them, they might not have all the tools today, but you don't know what they're gonna give other people tomorrow. So when I look at my students at Malaika, I ask them what they want to be. One of them tell me, I want to be an engineer, I want to be a lawyer. For me, I try to, you know, in my head, I do this stupid game where I try to think of the case the lawyer will defend. You know, that's very important case. And here, I am on the path trying to give her the tools to make her win that case. I talk about my student who wants to be an engineer. I'm trying to think when she's gonna send the first African person to Mars. And she will need to be able to solve this equation that I'm supposed to teach her today. So basically, I do like what I was doing when I was 4 or 5 years old. I make up story in my mind to celebrate little things and make them much bigger than they look, to give you a sense of purpose that, you know, you have to do this. And then I will follow up on small things like that, and people will think that, why is he doing this? It's because for me, they become much bigger than what they look like.
One more question, sorry.
Last question.
Yeah. So, global warming, the world does appear to be getting warm, but where is, in the idea of string theory, the wormhole back to Obama?
Okay, so yeah, this is a tough question. So in reality, I think that the situation we are in is just a very perfect situation, to be honest. I'm worried about what we will do if you know, this election went the other way and everybody was complacent and thinking that everything is so great. So there is a group of students I met on Facebook. They call themselves Black in Artificial Intelligence. They structure themselves as a group that is not shy to say we're black first. They organize school to bring black people in their community, and they're extremely successful. They use technology in a way that we don't. And I try to learn from them. So what I know is that we are really a resilient people. And sometimes when you see a struggle in front of us that is actually not so big of a struggle, I want to embrace the struggle. And I see a lot of people who are, for example, from Africa, with the presidency that we have right now, they kind of start doing more things in Africa than they would do otherwise. And so for me, it's just like, bring the wind, we're ready. We're ready to take it.
So I thought we'd have one of our students come and say thank you on behalf of the School of Science, Health, and Technology. Carlos Samuels.
Carlos! Dr. Ashwali, on behalf of the School of Science, Health, and Technology at Mary Griffiths College, I just want to say thank you for a wonderful and inspiring lecture today, and also for participating in this year's Dr. Frank Bradley Memorial Lecture today. Would you accept this?
Small token
over here.
So we should show you what we got for it.
My next t-shirt for the next seminar.
and courtesy of the RISE program, we got you a mug. Thank you very, very, very much. You're really wonderful.
So I'm trying to quarter the camera.
Thank you.